तो
वो तो हेल्पलेस तो पूरा दिन यही काम करता है, दो बजे से आ
लाइव,
जाता है रात
अच्छा इतना
तक।
काम हो रहा है, पूरी वर्ल्ड में
मनिंदर
पहुंच
वी आर
गए।
लाइव, मनिंदर वी आर लाइव, ओ लाइव ऑलरेडी
वी आर लाइव
स्टार्टेड।
ऑन यूट्यूब, वी आर ऑलरेडी लाइव ऑन यूट्यूब।
ओके
सो मीटिंग इन आवर स्ट्रीमिंग लाइव ऑन यूट्यूब।
चालू
सर यू आर
कहीं
लाइव, यू कैन स्टार्ट सर।
मोकलिंग
ओके सूर्य संजय रिकॉर्ड कर रहे हो ना? अरे
तरह तरह
मैम डॉक्टर अनीता साहब ग्रुप
मैं
में है नहीं अपने में?
कर ही
अरे
दो।
ग्रुप में है या जिग्नेश तुमको भेज
हाँ
दो।
मैं कर देता हूँ, मैं अनीता को भेज देता हूँ,
हाँ भेज दो अनीता को जरा।
अभी भेज देता हूँ।
YouTube का लिंक भेजा था इन्होंने? YouTube का लिंक है?
भेजा था यार।
I am putting the YouTube link here in the chat.
Please put it. Thank you.
That's the YouTube link in the Zoom group chat.
Thank you. Thank
you. I have sent it to Anita.
Namaskar. Queen of 19 Anupi Priya Havyakar.
मैं तो ने व्हाट्सएप पर मोकली जो
हाँ मोकलो
मोकली दी थी।
बट इफ डॉक्टर अनीता कांत इज टू स्टार्ट आई थिंक वी शुड स्टार्ट डॉक्टर आहूजा
मिस्टर संजय इज टू स्टार्ट
या व्हाट आई एम सेइंग इज द पेन अदर
पर्सन स्टार्ट विद द
इंट्रोडक्शन
सो लेट्स स्टार्ट मिस्टर संजय आप स्टार्ट कर दीजिए।
Good afternoon, respected faculty members and delegates. On the behalf of Sun Pharma, I welcome you all for this wonderful webinar on sleep disorders and menopause. And I invite Dr. Anita Kant to take us through the first session.
On this pleasant rainy afternoon, Kant, I welcome you all.
CV slides show kar dena.
Yeah.
To this webinar on sleep disturbances and related menopause disorders under the aegis of FOGSI, IMS and SMLM. At SMLM, Dr. Maninder always wanted to provide knowledge to medicos in their homes without traveling and without paying, and Corona has fulfilled this dream. Let me invite the three stalwarts who are all well known to us gynecologists in India and to all medicos, in fact, and abroad also. Professor Narinder Malhotra is Director and Donald School of Ultrasound and Professor at Sarajevo School of Science and Technology. At present, Vice President, World Association of Prenatal Medicine and SAFOC, Past President, ISPAT, ISAR, FOGSI, and so much more to his credit. Welcome, sir. Dr. Alpesh Gandhi is President FOGSI at present and has held many posts in FOGSI and even ICOG over the past years. He is very well known to all of us. Welcome to you too, sir. Dr. Jignesh Shah is President IMA and has been actively involved in FOGSI and IMS before this year. At present, he is leading the crusade of educating doctors about menopause and how women should be taught to enjoy it. Now I invite Dr. Anita Shah, Secretary General of IMS and another stalwart in IMS and FOGSI to take us through and introduce us to the speakers today.
Dr. Shah.
Naren Malhotra, to please give your address. Hello.
Hello.
Dr. Naren Malhotra.
Okay, so a very good evening to all of you, ladies and gentlemen. It's indeed a pleasure to be here on this webinar, a very interesting topic. Can we stop this slide share? Very interesting topic of sleep and sleep disorders. Now, these days, especially in COVID times, with so much stress of work, stress of getting scared of getting infected, stress of passing the infection to the others, and the work suffering and everything. So, and then staying at home and doing all the household works and all has led all, not only women, men and children also into a different new normal. And what has suffered in this new normal is the sleep. So we are not sleeping properly. We are not sleeping in time. We are not waking up in time. We are sleeping whenever we are free. And we are waking, eating and sleeping, eating and sleeping. That's most of us who have done over the last 3 months. So here is where willpower is required to control your schedules. So you have to very nicely plan your day, and with exercise, good diet, and adequate sleep at the right time and adequate entertainment. And this COVID has given us a great opportunity to bind and rebind with our families. And of course, learn a lot of hobbies. You see behind that, you see that painting? Those are the paintings I've made. So I never used to paint, and I'm painting now like a 2-year-old child, but it is pretty good for my first effort, my first painting of mountains and some houses, you know, which I believe where I should live. And this gives relaxation, and this gives what we call a sleep. So we should keep away from sleep-inducing drugs and tablets like Alprex, Rampose, and things like that. And we should be only getting sleep mentally. So all the best to Dr. Maninder. And I'm waiting to hear Manveer Bhatia, my very, very close old friend from college days, on what she has to say about sleep disorders. Thank you for inviting me here to address and to say a few words.
Thank you, Dr. Naren Mahotra. Now invite Dr. Alpesh Gandhi.
Thank you, Dr. Maninder. A very good afternoon to all of you. I am thankful to Dr. Rajendra, Midlife Committee Chairperson, Dr. Jignesh, IMS President, Dr. Maninder, SLMF, for inviting me for this very, very important webinar. I would like to congratulate all of you for continuing great academics and essential health services during this difficult time of COVID-19 pandemic. You all are doing good work and serving the women in India. I would like to take 2-3 minutes to thank all of you for supporting and community connect programs and schemes and projects. On 7th August, we had one community connect program to promote breastfeeding, and it was viewed by 52,100 women across India. It was a great success just because of support from all of you. Again, a very interesting, important academic program. Of course, it was a community connect and social program also on 10th of the August on preventable adolescent health care education, which was also appreciated by our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi, and which was again viewed by more than 121,000 boys and girls across India. So our dream to unreach is becoming successful with the support of all of you, from all of you. We have received received 10,000 questions during this program, and we are going to make a frequently asked question book on preventable adolescent health from these questions. We are going to select 500 to 1,000 questions from this, and we also have received 3,000 slogans and posters from adolescents and youth of India. They have suggested some very, very good, we have received very good suggestions from all of them. One of the good suggestions was to organize workshops for their parents and for their teachers. They expect that Foxy should also organize workshops for their parents and teachers. So they are expecting a lot from us. We want to take Foxy and its vision and its good work across India to each and every corner and all citizens of India. And with support from all of you, it is happening. I would also like to inform briefly about the incoming program. On 15th August, Independence Day, we are going to launch a 90 days campaign, Anemia Free India. And again, we want to reach to a mass level, we have expected in lakhs of women, and this will be also aired on radio. So many Radio Mirchi, Radio City, and on so many radios, you will find Foxy. So Foxy name will become, we are trying to make it a household name. We want to reach to each and every woman of India. We want to serve all of them. So and one more important program, we have planned on 17, 18, and 19th of the August. We want to reach to the paramedics, because the theme for this year is safety first for Indian women and Foxians. And when our paramedic staff are safe, when our patients are safe, we will also be safe. And to teach them, to train them how to take care during this COVID-19, we have a 3 days program for our paramedics. We are expecting more than 10,000 paramedics for this program. And this program module is based on WHO, and program is in support with the AIIMS Delhi. So I request all of you to please spread this message to as many as our members, so that their staff can also be benefited. It's Foxy's vision, and Foxy always have great respect and regards for its sister concerns, sister organizations. And today I am happy that one of the committee, midlife committee of Foxy and IMS, are organizing this program jointly. We want more and more such programs in collaboration. We believe in collaboration. And for that, once again, I congratulate Dr. Rajendra Nagarkatti and Dr. Jignesh Sa. Dr. Jignesh is a very good friend of mine, working very hard and efficiently in this difficult time. I also would like to congratulate Maninder for organizing this interesting, important, very useful, as Dr. Narendra has mentioned. I will not go in detail of it, but I would say only one thing. There is one more pandemic in this pandemic, and that is pandemic of fear. And because of this pandemic of fear, also there are so many mental problems, mental health problems, and one of these problems is also disturbances in sleep and insomnia and many others. So thank you very much for organizing this very, very important, though it is important, a less discussed and less discussed topic, but I hope today we will have a great deliberation. And if you can send this video recording of this program to Foxy, I would like to upload this on Foxy's website, so that all those who could not attend the program can be benefited from this scientific deliberation. Once again, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, for inviting me, for supporting Foxy, and I wish a great success to this webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Jignesh Sa. I think thank you, Dr. Alpesh. It was a wonderful, I think, information. All the three of you are my real great friends for a long time. So it doesn't mean matter whom I am calling. So now the next is, we'll invite Dr. Jignesh Sa. And he is the present president of the Indian Menopause Society, as already he has been introduced. So please, for a few words on the sleep disorders and collaborations of all the three societies.
First of all, let me start with a big thank to Dr. Alpesh, my good friend, for telling me a hard worker. Because if I am a hard worker, he is a very, very, very hard worker. Right, Alpesh? Thank you, Maninder.
I don't know about myself, but you are a hard worker.
Thank you, Maninder, for organizing today's webinar. and thanks for today's invite also, and thanks to Sun Pharma for supporting today's webinar. Friends, let me take this opportunity to introduce Indian Menopause Society to all the viewers across the country. Indian Menopause Society is a multidisciplinary society which was established in 1995, and this year 2020 we are celebrating Silver Jubilee year. We are having 45 branches either in form of societies or chapters spread across the country in all the states of India. Friends, all our past presidents had worked very hard for spreading awareness message about menopausal health problems and its management amongst gynecologists, amongst paramedical person, as well as to the public. And I'm very happy to say that today we are successful in creating awareness in the patients as well as in the clinician. But the same thing is not observed in clinical practice. As it is said, many people know what to do, but only few do it. This year, our theme is Flying High with the Wings of Menopause, and motto of the year is Preventing the Preventable. In the Silver Jubilee year, that is 2020, even in this suffering from Corona, lockdown and difficult situation, our aim is to apply our clinical knowledge to our clinical practice to build a bridge to reach the unreached, to provide quality of life to our menopausal women. And because direct CMEs are not possible, we are going through webinars, and some way we are successful also. Today's webinar on sleep disturbances during menopause or in midlife, which is very important in management of menopause, as about 60% of women in midlife are suffering from sleep disturbances like sleep apnea, disturbed rhythm of sleep, inadequate sleep. How to solve this dilemma of sleep, that will be discussed in detail by very renowned speaker, Dr. Manveer Bhatia, about whom I have heard a lot with Maninder and also by Sonia Malik. She will be discussing this in length. And after that, the panel discussion will be there by Maninder, in which a galaxy of panelists like my close friend, Dr. Raju Nagarkatti, Dr. Sonia Malik, past president of Indian Menopause Society, Parag Biniwale, ICOG secretary, and one more panelist. I look forward for very interesting panel and my sincere best wishes to today's webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jignesh Bhai. Maninder, should I take over?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Jignesh Bhai, for kind words. First of all, thanks a lot to dear Maninder and Dr. Anita Kant for giving me this opportunity to this such a unique webinar. First of all, my sincere thanks to all of you for this unique webinar on sleep disturbances. Nowadays, we all are busy with different webinars in day out and day in, but this is something different. So I am sure all of us and all of you will enjoy this webinar on sleep disturbances. For that, I would like to invite our very renowned personality, Dr. Manveer Bhatia, who is going to discuss sleep disturbances in midlife. Dr. Manveer Bhatia is a director of the Neurology Sleep Center, New Delhi. She's a vice president of the Indian Society of Sleep Research. She was additional professor and in charge of neuroelectrophysiology, sleep medicine of AIMS, New Delhi. She was chairperson of sleep medicine, senior neurology consultant at Sir Gaurgama Hospital, New Delhi. She was chairperson of sleep medicine, senior consultant neurology, Medanta Gurgaon. And she was director of sleep medicine and senior neurology at Fortis Hospital at New Delhi also. So today, without wasting time, I would like to hand over the mic to Dr. Manveer Bhatia. We are very much eager to know about different problems regarding sleep disturbances and solution of that. So, dear Manveer, mic is yours.
I'd like to thank the organizers and people from all various aspects of the Foxy Society, the Menopause Society, and the Midlife Society. And I think listening to you, the president, what all they're doing and how they're reaching out to so many women all over the country, I think it's really admirable. So without kind of spending more time, I'm going to just enter the topic, as I do have some lot to cover, but we'll see how it goes. I'm going to just share my screen. Sanjay, can I do that? Yeah. So the topic says that it's the sleep issues in, primarily I've focused on the menopause, not so much on the perimenopausal, because if I start looking at the sleep in the various aspects along the woman's life, it changes dramatically. So we have teenagers, adolescents with their own issues. We have the young women with their pregnancy, the perimenopause and the menopause we've clubbed together. So I thought Dr. Sonia Malik actually raised the question that what is the main theme and what is it that I'm wanting to convey? So I thought the first thing is that, do we all agree that sleep issues are common in menopause, or do we disagree? Is this a topic which needs a lot of focus and some more depth? And second is then, if yes, so what are these common sleep issues? I have broken them into some case presentations, and we will deal with the cases as we go along. But before we go into the sleep issues, I thought I would touch a little bit about what is sleep. It is a dimension, it's a multidimensional state actually. So I wanted to touch that and actually end with the final message. So how to diagnose these problems and how to treat them in our day-to-day practice. From the gynecological perspective, of course. And it is like when I was searching through these articles, and you'll be surprised to know that there are enough in the menopausal journals, and there are enough in the lots of articles in the Journal of Clinical Medicine and the Journal of Sleep. So menopause-related sleep disorders, in fact, are a big focus and a big force to be talked about. And all of them say one thing, that sleep difficulty is one of the hallmarks of menopause. So if we consider menopause as being a transition period or a change in the physical, the psychological, endocrinal, bone, etc. health, sleep health is also a very, very big contender in that list. So when people who are seeing patients or people, let's say not patients, in this age of their life, we should think about sleep as a big issue. And it's already been mentioned. So how common is this? Lots of data available. They range from almost 25, 30, 45, 50, 60% of women in this age group will have a sleep-related issues. What is the impact of this? The impact, to put it just in simple words, it impacts all aspects of their life. That is their physical health, their mental health, their cognitive emotional health, and overall a very poor quality of life. So what are these common conditions? So I'm not going into the details of the classification of disorders, etc. What do the women commonly present as? The first and foremost is insomnia. So we will touch a little bit more in depth about this insomnia and how we can manage these people in our day-to-day practice, and end with this message or a thought, and when should a specialist be brought into the picture. So insomnia, 41% higher risk of developing this. It's much higher in women on the whole, but women beyond 60, it touches almost a 73% higher risk. What about sleep apnea? We'll talk about sleep apnea in a little bit more detail, but just to say that premenopausal, the women have a lower risk of sleep apnea. postmenopausal, the risk becomes equal to men. And the other entity is something called as restless leg syndrome, which I will share a few cases with you. In fact, I've seen them a lot during this last 1 month or so. And the insomnia numbers also I have seen have considerably gone up in the last few months. So these are the kind of disorders that we will see. I'm not sure how many are aware of this. This was a very interesting, this is called as a SWAN study. Lot of data is available from the SWAN study. This is a study of women's health across the nation. And it has multiple agencies have come together to put this forward. They have taken women in the age groups of about 45 to 60, and they have followed them over the years. So there are about 3,000 women who are being followed, the biological, the psychological, the studies have data has come out of all these entities. So what did they say? They also said that what are the ones which are really of big importance? There is increased depression and anxiety, the urinary symptoms, there is a mild change in their cognitive ability, definite increase in their sleep complaints. And of course, then you have the other physical changes which come up, and those could all be. So there is, even in the SWAN study, it has been shown that sleep issues are a very big factor. Why do they occur? Why does this happen? And you know, in your gynecologist, so you all are more well-versed than me, but the two major hormones, I'm only going to talk about the effect of these hormones on sleep. So one is progesterone and one is estrogen. Progesterone effect or the impact is much more simpler. It has an action on the benzoreceptors, and this increases the GABA, and GABA has a calming effect and a sleep inducing effect. So when progesterone decreases, it will produce insomnia. So what about estrogen? Estrogen effect is a little bit more complicated. In fact, it has three types of effects that it has. One is primarily on the sleep. It definitely has a beneficial effect to improve sleep quality, in simple words. Second, estrogen has an impact on the temperature regulation. So thus, if the estrogen is lacking, and that's why you will get all those vasomotor symptoms, which are a big contributing factor towards the insomnia. And the third is an effect on mood. So estrogen has a mood elevating effect, and the lack of estrogen will have a tendency to produce a low mood or tendency towards a depression. So thus, estrogen has numerous beneficial effects on the body. So second part I'm going to just touch upon. So what is sleep? Sleep, like I said, it's a multidimensional thing that we should think about. What are the dimensions? We talk about the timing of sleep. We talk about duration of sleep. We talk about quality of sleep. And we talk about this feeling of overall being rested or good quality of sleep. But as a definition, this is a reversible state, which we all agree. Otherwise, it would be like coma or something which you would not wake up from. There is a disengagement and an unresponsiveness to the environment. That's how sleep is defined. And of course, in human beings, it's supine with eyes closed. But to go a little more deeper, we all understand a lot about the quantity of sleep. That dimension is easy to understand because it's the number of hours that you sleep. So the person, the time, I think Dr. Malhotra said, the time that you sleep, the time that you wake up, that gives you total number of hours. But that's a very, very simplistic way of looking at sleep. So what about the second dimension? And that is the quality of sleep. The sleep is divided into two broad major stages. One is called as the rapid eye movement sleep, and the second is called as the non-rapid eye movement. How are they distinguished? In the rapid eye movement, the eyeballs move very fast, and that's rapid eye, and the non-rapid eye. The non-rapid eye is further divided into three stages. I mean, you might think that, you know, this is why this information is important, but I just want to say that in adults, up till almost 60, 65 years, we know the amount of time that one should spend in these stages to feel rested when you get up. So overall, in one night, the rapid eye movement is about 20 to 25% of your time. and the non-rapid eye movement forms about 70-75%. In the further subdivision, stage one is a very light sleep. It's that situation that, you know, when you are lying down, you're just entering into sleep. You can feel or hear somebody walking around, putting some lights off, etc. And you are able to respond if somebody calls out your name. Stage two is like a medium level of sleep, which is very important for memory. And stage three is the deep sleep. Out of these three stages, the bulk is a stage two, but we need about 15 to 20% of stage three. So there can be two scenarios: that you sleep 8 hours, but get up feeling tired or unrested. Why does that happen? Could be that there was no stage three. So you were fluctuating between the light stage, and that's what most women with insomnia in the postmenopausal will complain of. That I can be in bed, I may be sleeping, but I don't get up feeling fresh. I'm tired. And I'm always, brain is thinking, it's racing. So they are just hovering around stage one of sleep. So this is a, I want to show this, another diagram for sleep. This gives you the over, the complete night evaluation of sleep. So what does it do? This is called as a hypnogram. First, this is the person is awake, enters into the stage one, then stage two. The stage three and four were called earlier as three and four. Now they've been clubbed together as a slow wave sleep. Then you go into slow wave sleep, and this, the shaded blue areas are the rapid eye movement sleep. So this is showing you that over the night, what happens? So you go through this cycle, and usually there are five such cycles. So if you have less than these number of cycles, you will again get up feeling unrested. That's one part. So, and if you don't get the slow wave sleep, then again, you'll be unrested. So this is a hypnogram of a person who has disrupted sleep. What happens? There is no slow wave sleep and there is no REM sleep. And there is, so in bed for 8 hours, but lots of awakenings and arousals. So this is a hypnogram from a patient who has a typical complaint of insomnia. I want to touch briefly about the control of sleep, because the whole aspect of treatment depends on this. We need to understand what keeps us awake and what helps us to sleep. There are two major processes. So the one is a homeostatic drive. In simple words, it is the number of hours you stay awake prior to the bedtime, and that will consolidate the amount of sleep you have. In simple words, that if you stay awake the whole day, the sleep drive, so this is the sleep drive in the morning, it's very low. As the day goes on, this drive accumulates, and at night you feel sleepy and you will sleep. But why is this important? This is important when we talk about treatment. If you take short naps during the day, you will kill or abolish this homeostatic drive, and the night sleep will never be good, irrespective of the number of pills that you swallow. So this is the forms, the basis of our treatment, that we need to improve their homeostatic drive or strengthen this drive. It is exactly like, if to make it simpler, it's like if you fast. If the longer you stay hungry, the bigger the desire or greater the appetite to eat at night, after a few hours. But if you eat small fractions through the day, you don't feel like eating a meal. And the second factor is called as a circadian system or the circadian rhythm. This is an inbuilt biological clock. In fact, the Nobel Prize was given a few years ago to the three scientists who talked a lot more about this. But all that I want to say, this is an inbuilt clock. There is a master clock in the brain. And this is by the secretion of the chemical called melatonin. But there are miniature clocks in the whole body, which kind of run in sync together. So these two drives work together to keep you awake and asleep. So there are things like small naps. There are things like coffee, which will block the adenosine and block the homeostatic. And there are things like screen time, Netflix, which will block your circadian drive. And these are the important things to remember when we talk about treatment. So I'll discuss now two cases, and in the rest of the talk, we'll talk about how to manage the cases. So this is a 59 years old lady. Let's call her Mrs. K. She was a working woman. And when they come, they almost can't remember how long the sleep problem has been. They will tell you, I can't remember. Maybe it's 10 years, maybe it's 12 years. I've never slept well. So then you ask a little bit more in details. And she says, yes, I've always had to wake up very early because I used to go for work. But recently parents are not well, so she's looking after them. And this is exactly what, you know, we were talking in the beginning. So what all has she tried so far? If she has been symptomatic for 12 years, she's had to obviously done something about her sleep. So she's tried diazepam, she's tried zolpidem, she's tried clonazepam. And by the time she came, she was almost taking 3 zolpidems in the night. Like she would take one middle of the night, early morning, keep taking zolpidems. Then she felt that my memory is giving me problems. So she stopped the zolpidem. Sleep obviously became very bad. Then she went on to Ativans, and which she takes maybe 2, and then she repeats them again. By and large, this is the story which people come with when they come to us who have had long-standing insomnia. What else happened? She started having this thing called as nocturnal eating, we call it, that there were increased desire to eat at night, and her weight has gone up. And there is a continuous worry about sleep. She's very tired during the day. She feels very low. She feels physically very unfit, and she doesn't feel good at all. And that's what it is. So what is the problem? There is chronic insomnia. We are very clear about that. What else? There is a dependence on the medication. What else? She's got tolerance, meaning the doses need to be increased. Third thing, she's developed side effects. So what do we do now is the question. And this we will talk once we talk about the management. So remember this case, she's a long-standing insomniac and with medicines, and medicines are failing now. So this is another lady. Now she's actually only 50. She was in fact crying and weeping bitterly when she was came to the clinic. And what was the problem? That I just can't sleep. I'm up the whole night and I can't sleep. Some past medical history, she has had severe cardiac problems for which she was had an external implantable device, which was one of the rare things that she had. And she said, yes, you know, I was very worried about it. Don't know what, it's one of the few in the country. I was sad, but I've got over it, but my sleep has not got better. And she said that there's almost no sleep the whole night. She's walking around. In fact, she came with her husband and her son, and everybody's awake the whole night, half the night. What all has she tried? She's tried zolpidem. She's tried Stilnox, which is an extended release zolpidem. She's tried ultrasets. Nothing seems to be working. So this is another lady who has chronic insomnia, and now we have to manage her. What is insomnia is what we should talk about. So insomnia is poor sleep, but it has some definitions. We have difficulty. So we need to understand what is the problem with the sleep. You can't fall asleep, you can't stay asleep, or you have early morning awakening despite adequate opportunity, and there should be a daytime impairment, meaning that I'm not feeling good in the day. It could be physical symptoms, emotional symptoms are all during the day. Based on this, there is a classification. Just simple to put it, it's short term, chronic, and others. And this, the barrier between the short and the chronic is the 3 months. So symptoms more than 3 months are said to be chronic. This is just, I want to introduce just another concept, and then maybe we can go straight to management. This is also relevant for the treatment. So there are two models for this insomnia. One is a very good clinical model, which I apply to most of my patients. It's called as a 3P model. And this is by Dr. Spielberg. So what are the 3 P's? First P is the predisposing factor. So what do we mean by that? It means it's the personality. You know, we know that some people are the worriers, the thinkers, as we call them. For every little thing, they'll get really very anxious, very worried. Some people are very sensitive to the light, to the sound. So those are the worriers. Then comes an event in their life. So this event can be an illness, can be a separation, can be a loss of a loved one, can be changing a home, any small thing. So usually when you get insomnia, when this event occurs, you will get the insomnia, but you will bounce back. But the third P is the biggest culprit, and that's called as the perpetuating factor. So what are these factors? Number one is worry about sleep. So continuous worry about sleep. So in fact, now it's said that insomnia is a 24-hour disorder. It's not a night disorder because people, the whole day is focused on the sleep. Second is they stay in bed through the day. Those are called as maladaptive methods to tackle it and such things. And so then the third is relation of this night to everything in the day. So that factor makes any insomnia chronic. So I hope, second theory is an arousal theory. Now it's known that these people who have insomnia, they have a physical and a physiological resetting. The temperatures are higher, the baseline pulse rates are higher. So they are definitely more prone to get insomnia. So they are in a state of arousal and we need to calm them down. These effects we've talked about. So I'm going to just talk about the vasomotor. I'm not talking. I think somebody else is going to talk a lot about more of the hot flashes and the night sweats, etc. I'll talk about insomnia and depression. And this is what is called as a chicken and the egg story. So what starts first? There is decreased estrogen. There are definitely hot flashes. They cause a poor sleep. This poor sleep results, which is called a sleep disruption. And this will cause a lot of negative thinking. The negative thinking will produce depression. And the depression further will worsen the sleep. So in this vicious circle, by the time the patient comes to us, we don't know what is triggered and what has reached. But we have to find mechanisms that we break the circle and improve their night. And that's what we need to do. What is the second condition? It is called as obstructive sleep apnea. Obstruction, as the word says, is obstruction. Sleep, during sleep, apnea means there are difficulty in breathing. So what really happens? Normally the air goes in through the nose, posterior pharyngeal wall, and it will go in at night. But in some people, there is a complete obstruction. So why does it happen? In women postmenopausal, there is a tendency to gain weight. Once the weight is around the abdomen, the neck circumference will also increase and the airway gets narrower, and that's what the sound occurs. So that's one of the, and second, of course, is the estrogen goes down, testosterone comes up, and they can have a similar problem. What about restless leg syndrome? This is an entity which is often missed, and I'm just going to skip these slides. But just to tell you that menopause can produce, is a high risk for cardiovascular. It is a high risk for obstructive sleep apnea, which is also caused for high risk. I just want to talk about this restless leg syndrome. It has simple four criteria, but we can put them in one line. So what do the patients complain of? There is this discomfort in the legs. In fact, in the last few days, I've heard people used all kinds of terms. Somebody called it as ghabraat hoti hai taangon mein. Somebody said, my legs make me get up and make them walk and dance. So it's a very unpleasant sensation. This occurs at a time of rest. It worse in the evening and it is relieved by movement. So the typical story is that I go to lie down in the bed, my legs, something starts happening. I get up and I move and I get relief. So some people are walking for 2 hours, 3 hours, then like that. Or they want a rub, a massage. Some people immerse their feet in cold water, hot water, etc. So this is restless leg syndrome. It's a very, very common condition. I'm going to skip the rest of the slides and come to the management. But this one information, that when we take a sleep history, remember, it is not just one line that, okay, you have insomnia. We need to spend, I spend average of 30 to 40 minutes on a sleep history. We need to know their complete day, night, what time they sleep, what time they get up, weekdays, weekends, etc. Also have additional questions about any other medical condition. Lots of medications can cause insomnia. What treatments they have tried so far. Some people revert to alcohol, some people revert to substance abuse, some people revert to medications. So what all have they tried? And of course, ask the bed partner. If necessary, we will also do some psychological assessments. There are also some scales. I'm not going to talk about the scales right now, which can give you some information about the insomnia and the severity of insomnia. So one is the Pittsburgh Sleep Quality Index and one is the Insomnia Severity Index. So at the end of history, what should you have or what should you know? You should know what is the patient having insomnia, generate a differential diagnosis. And now the recommendation is that we should have a discussion with the patient and plan the treatment forward. It's not a one-time meeting which can solve a problem for 12 years or 15 years. And this is an article that I often quote, but this was an interesting thing that we talk about getting a good history, but how much time do we spend with the patient? So this research said the doctors interrupt the patients almost after an 11 seconds. So idea is let them talk, let us listen, and then we'll be much wiser. So Dr. Maninder, I'll start ending.
Okay. The rest of the things we can take up in the panel.
Yeah, okay. So I'm just going to analyze these two, three cases that we discussed and then we will end. Yes. So this is Mrs. the first case, remember we talked about. And there was one hint which came that she was a very loud snorer. So along with all that she had loud snoring. So her problems were chronic insomnia, dependence, tolerance, but she also had. So I would like the people who are attending in the chat box, if they can answer 1, 2, 3, or they feel more than one, that's also fine. We can give about 15 seconds to people to answer in their chat box. What do they think should one is a diagnosis? Is it chronic depression? Is there anxiety? Or do you think it's a primary sleep disorder? Or do you think it's a combination? Okay, time starts now. Manish is managing. Can you manage and just let's see how many we get?
Many are watching on the YouTube, I think. Can they see the poll?
Let's see. Manish, did you get anything in the chat? Okay, so somebody said primary sleep disorder. We'll wait for another few seconds, otherwise we'll end it. Okay, so I think probably there was a combination of both. She definitely has a primary sleep disorder, which we need to think about. So what should we do then next? Should we do an overnight sleep study? Should we do some biochemical? Should we do psychological? So obviously we did an overnight sleep study and we found that if I applied the 3P model, she fitted into a lot of things, but she also had the snoring. And the sleep study showed severe sleep apnea. And this is what her sleep diary was like, which we can talk later. This is what her sleep study was. She has large, these red blocks are all apnea periods. Her oxygen saturation is remaining low and she was markedly better with the treatment.
Dr. Bhatia.
Yes.
Ma'am, there are many questions came. The question link is in chat box.
But that we will do later on. I think let's do the question answers, Manvi, later on.
Okay, we'll do question answers later, Dr. Sanjay. Okay. Mr. Sanjay.
Okay.
So this is a second lady who we said came crying. She also had one little hint, which was that I keep hitting my legs the whole night. So what was the possibility? She had a possibility that she was having the entity called as restless leg syndrome. So again, people can think about it. Does she have depression? Does she have anxiety? She definitely had a medical illness, cardiac illness, and she had a primary sleep disorder. She had an urge to move the legs. They were worsening at night and she was awake the whole night. So the take home message, multiple disorders can be in the same patient. In fact, there was a recommendation that people or women above 40 years start screening them because they will worsen during menopause and you offer some anticipatory guidance. I'm going to skip the case and I will just go to the management now. This was a third case who was another typical case, but who had a generalized anxiety disorder. And again, we had to deal with it in a different manner. So treatment of insomnia, what do we really want to do when we are trying to treat these people? You want to improve their night. That's what they want. They want to improve their day, and you want to improve the overall quality of life. And that's how you will improve their health and their emotional well-being. There are two major guidelines which are there, which are available on the net, so people can look at them in greater detail. One is the clinical practice guideline for pharmacology by the American Society. And then there is also a guideline in postmenopausal women with insomnia. And there is also another guideline for the American College of Physicians. But on the gist of it, what they all say, which is what I want to say, is the recommendation is that cognitive behavioral therapy, so what is CBT? It is a set of techniques to improve your homeostatic drive and your circadian drive, should remain as the mainstay and the first option for treatment. Pharmacological measures are to be taken as a second option and along with CBTI. So in short, what I want to do is stress a lot about CBTI. CBTI is cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia. It has these following components. It has sleep hygiene, sleep restriction, stimulus control, relaxation, and cognitive behavior. We don't have time to go into all of them, but just remember that these are administered as a series, either as a 4-week or a 6-week program by trained people. And this is what is known, that it will help insomnia. Medications are not going to help insomnia by themselves. What are the medicines so far? They're the benzodiazepine drugs, the Z drugs, antidepressants, melatonin receptor agonists, and we have a new kid on the block, which is not yet available in our country. And those are called as the wake promoting hormone is orexin. So you suppress the orexin. This is ideally going to be most physiological, and hopefully we should have them soon. And of course, these are some tics. So the first lady, what did we do? We gave her a CPAP. She was offered suggestions for weight reduction. Her sedatives were taken off. And as a follow-up, she has lost weight, energy is much better, and she's off the sedatives. The second lady was restless leg syndrome. She was also given treatment, and she is almost 100% cured and markedly better. All that weeping, crying has totally stopped. The third lady was given sessions with the psychologist who had a generalized anxiety disorder. She was given an SSRI and CBTI, and she's also much better. So thus, there is hope for insomnia, for chronic insomnia, but we need to find out the exact cause. The management should consist of CBTI medications, but the most important thing is treat the cause. So in summary, I started by saying a few things, that are sleep issues common? Yes. Should we detect them? Yes. How to diagnose? 80% of the job is by history. The ancillary tools, sleep study, sleep diaries can be used, but once we have a full history, how to treat them? Most important is to treat the cause. When to refer to a specialist? So I think chronic insomnia, not settling, increasing their doses by themselves, please think about referring to a specialist. So this is just the book that we put together. I've also launched an online teaching institute for sleep medicine, in which we have put a lot of courses for sleep professionals. And I've actually just put up two courses on Udemy now, also for the public, because I'm looking at the issue of sleep in the country. I feel we needed more awareness. Thank you so much for your patient listening.
Thank you very much, Dr. Manveer Bhatia, for an excellent presentation. You did the whole presentation in a very lucid way, but similarly at the same time, very simple way. So I think everyone has understood everything. You have not turned a single stone unturned. Then also, if anybody is having any query, that will be covered after that panel discussion. Now, friends, so many times we know everything. We know the treatment, management, everything, but sometimes it is very difficult to put in the practice. Practical knowledge is at the same time very, very important. So to understand the whole management part of the sleep disorders in midlife and menopause, we have none other than our dancing, smiling lady, Dr. Maninda Rahuja, for with us. Everyone, for Foxy people as well as Indian Menopause Society's members, she doesn't need any introduction. But then also, I would like to say a few words regarding Maninda. She is practicing since last 40 years for betterment of the adolescents to menopausal women at her Ahuja Hospital. She was an honorary professor of Indian Menopause, Medical Association. She was president of Society of Meaningful Life Management, which she has started to make and to gather everybody at the same platform for treating a woman from adolescence to menopause. It is a really, really very important work and plan what she has made. She was president of Indian Menopause Society. She was vice president of Foxy for 2013 and 14. She was the founder chapter secretary of Faridabad Menopause Society. And she has done so many publications, as well as she has received so many awards, that if I will describe all of them, then it will take a lot much time. So Maninder had told me that don't tell everything. Everyone is knowing everything. So no need to describe and present everything. But she had received a Best Foxian Award, for Best Rotarian Award, and I am a National Award also. So Maninder, I don't waste much time. The mic is yours. I think you would like to introduce your panelist, and then you will conduct the panel. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Anita Shah, for the very kind words and wonderful introduction. And after, I think, Dr. Manveer Bhatia's talk, our work will become easy, and my panelists will also be eased out because it's a new topic. And being a new topic, everybody is stressed out. So let's not cause it our sleep problem. So I think I'll start sharing the screen. Yes, so our today's talk is now, panel discussion is about sleep disorders in menopause. Now, Dr. Manveer has covered very nicely about all the phases of life and what are the sleep disorders are. But in between, we'll be again inviting her to give her comments, because I think many joined late also. So those people will also be benefited if we are going to talk it again, repeat a few things. So sleep disorders and dysfunction, these are the two things. So our great panelists today, I think they don't need any introduction, but just in a couple of lines, Dr. Sonia Malik, she was the president of Indian Menopause Society, IFS, a very versatile personality, and who is very fond of reading and contributing academically also. That's why she's associate editor of SC Asia Journal also. Then she was the chief editor of Journal of Midlife Health also, and involved into many other publications also. And I think we are going to gather a lot from her. And Prag Binivala is a great friend for many years. We have been working together. And again, very enthusiastic person and very, very sporting person. At this present time, he is the secretary of the ICOG. And whatever ICOG 1.0 we are getting is because of his efforts only, and of course, because of the efforts of Dr. Rajinder Nagarkati, who is the chairperson of the Midlife Management Committee. And I must tell you, he has been taking me along within all his program, whatever he was doing, because I had literally handed him over the Midlife Management Committee. So you have all heard Manveer Bhatia. She does not need any introduction. And I have known her for many years. And it was through Dr. Naren Mohotra only that we were introduced. And Dr. Naren Mohotra was the first who had started the sleep clinics also. And I think the aim of today's talk is that we perhaps need more of sleep therapists at sleep clinics also, because sleep keeps us healthy and functioning well, that we have heard. And why we need to talk about menopausal women is because of the sheer number. In India itself, 103 million women by 2026. And the average age of being 46.7 years, all over the world, 52 years. And in the perimenopausal age group, when they go into that transition, 33 to 51% complain of these sleep disturbances. And they increased from the perimenopause, but after menopause, of course, they are a little less. But they do impact health-related quality of life. And we need these women as the productive and active workforce. That is why the sleep disorder, which has been least talked about in our circles, needs a little more discussions, detailed discussions, how we should be managing women with sleep disorders in the perimenopause and menopause age group. And my friend, one of them, when I asked her to please attend this webinar, she said, I don't have sleep disturbances. But your patient will be having. Then she said, we refer them to neurologists or the physician. So then I realized how much the unmet need is there for the sleep therapist. So today, what we'll be going through is just, is menopause the cause of sleep disorder? Are menopause symptoms responsible for it? How to diagnose? Because we'll just going through clinically only. Other health hazards which are associated with sleep disorder. How to manage, when to refer, that is very important, when to refer the patient, and what is sleep hygiene, because that is what all of us have to know. So there will be two cases, we'll be going simultaneously from one case to another. Mrs. Meenakshi is 54 years old, she's 4 years into menopause, she had menopause at the age of 50 years, still she now complains of hot flushes. She won't say like hot flushes, ghabrahat hoti hai. I feel ghabrahat, I feel restless, and I can't sleep at night. I go to sweating state at night and I get up. On further exploring, she told me that yes, she has some sexuality problem and burning issues, vaginal burning and irritation also. So the main thing is this is affecting her quality of life. She is obese with a BMI 33. Now, another case is she also 52 years old and 2 years into menopause. And from 2 years, she's having worsening insomnia. But along with associated are increased hot flushes, which is saying she gets hot and cold, and then she cannot sleep in the night even. So they are particularly bothersome to her. But what is more bothersome to her was nocturia. She told me she can't control it. And she has just to run it to the bathroom, but before she reaches, she gets her wet, and that the same problem is continuing at night also. So perhaps that is what she's thinking, that is affecting her sleep also. So my question first to Prag Beniwale, are you there?
Yes.
Yeah. So what are the physiological hormonal, what is menopause, and what are the physiological changes which are occurring in menopause? What are the hormonal changes which are occurring in menopause?
Okay. Manindra, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me and having this different topic. And it was a wonderful to listen to Dr. Manveer. It was such a in-depth deliberation about sleep that, you know, a lot of concepts were really cleared. So thank you, Manveer, for that. Now, all of us know that menopause is an important phase in the woman's life. And we say that when the woman stops menstruating after a span of 1 year, we say that she has entered the menopausal phase. It also means that the ovarian function has reduced and eventually stopped. So the ovulation is no more there, and the production of estrogen also goes down. And that is the reason why women start developing various symptoms. And of course, then they do report to us with all sorts of problems.
So, Dr. Parag Beniwale, thank you for highlighting that there is ovarian function which is stopped. So ovarian follicle depletion is there, and there are decreased estradiol, inhibin AMH, and increased FSH LH. So are we measuring these menopausal symptoms on menopause rating scale?
Of course, we can do that. And then it is important that we take history in detail. And when we take history in detail, it's a good idea for all of us to refer to the menopause rating scale, because it will tell us exactly the problem that she's facing, whether she's facing somatic, her symptoms are somatic or sexual or otherwise, or even urogenital. And then it will also tell us whether the symptoms are mild, moderate, or severe. And depending on all these factors, we decide whether she requires any treatment and what kind of treatment she requires. So here, when we talk about menopause rating scale, the first thing we would be noting about is hot flashes. That is the commonest symptom, and sweating. Second is about heart discomfort. So breathing issues or palpitations and stuff like that. Third, very important aspect is sleep problems. Then fourth is depression, irritability, anxiety, feeling of exhaustion. Many a times women come to us saying that they feel tired and they don't have any energy to do anything. So that is also something which we have to keep in mind. And we should not forget the urogenital problems, because they may come to us very uncommonly in our part of the country with sexual problems, but they can report dryness of vagina or bladder issues. And not to forget the issues related to joints and bones. So in all, we need to take history in detail and find out what exactly is the score. And then depending on that, we take a call as to what kind of therapies to be offered.
Thank you, Dr. Parag. And what are the evidence says that also shows us the same thing, that the subjective symptoms of sleep problems and vasomotor problems, they go on increasing with the hot vasomotor symptoms and sleep disorders. They go hand in hand. And more vasomotor symptoms, more sleep disorders are there. And self-reported symptoms are more there. Almost three times more likely to report with the moderate and severe hot flashes, sleep disturbances are there. And the three types of sleep disturbances which are there, which have been reported in the Swan study also, which Manveer also quoted, that there is difficulty in staying asleep, difficulty in falling asleep, and there is the early morning awakening also. So this has been proved by various studies. And difference between sleep disturbance and disorder is there. That disorder is just perceived for a little while only, but this disturbance is perceived for a little while. And disorder is a constellation of symptoms which they need criteria for insomnia syndrome, and they need the treatment also. So how are estrogens related to sleep disorders? I think she has already highlighted, but Parag, can you take it up quickly, how the sleep disorder estrogen deficiency is causing sleep disorders?
Right. Manindar, the slide is self-explanatory, and I think all of us can read it. And then it is the one which is responsible for regulation of body temperature. It is responsible for making sure that the moods are well. And it also does have some amount of antidepressant effects. And all these factors will certainly help in a good amount of sleep. Progesterone, I believe, does not have much role as, it is not as important as estrogen, though it has some amount of sedative or anxiolytic effect. But estrogen definitely, I would say, is much more important as far as sleep patterns.
But when we have to give when we'll be going into the treatment, then we'll find out how the menopause hormone therapy is going to help us.
Yeah.
Even the progesterone part is going to help us. And some studies they have done FSH level and their relationship to their sleep disturbances, and they have found that the increased FSH levels are also related to sleep disturbances. Dr. Rajendra Nagarkoti, do you think nocturia is causing sleep disturbances, and how it can cause?
I think, thank you, Dr. Manindra, madam. Once again, I wish to thank Dr. Manindra, madam. She's been a guiding force. She's been my mentor in this particular field. And as she said, I generally try to talk to her during all the programs and take suggestions from her. So regarding this question, can nocturia cause sleep problems? Yes, basically, definitely it can cause, because it disturbs the sleep pattern. and more so in perimenopausal or postmenopausal women, because of the urogenital syndrome, they have the vaginal, the vulval and the vaginal atrophy to recurrent UTI, and probably that also can be a cause of nocturia. Plus also they have sometimes an overactive bladder, which sort of translates into nocturia. So these problems can disturb their sleep, because I think as Manveer Madam has already said, once the pattern is disturbed, then going back to sleep becomes an issue, and that is how it can lead to the problem, you know, sort of it becomes a vicious cycle.
Yeah, Rajendra, thank you very much. You have explained it very nicely that the pattern is disturbed. So that's why the then the sleep disturbances are there. So whenever the carry home message is that whenever patients come to us with one of the symptoms, ghabrahat or anything, we should go into details of the menopause rating scale also, and specifically ask about the quality of sleep issues, because they are not going to tell us like that. We will Absolutely. Have to go, because they take it for granted, okay, this is happening because of age and all that, and they don't take it seriously. Dr. Sonia Malik, everybody is talking about FSH, estrogen, progesterone. But do you think that a new hormone like melatonin also has a role to play? And what is this hormone? That's just we want to know from you for the present.
So thank you. Of course, your thinking has always been out of the box. And this is yet another example of your out of the box thinking, this webinar of sleep disorders. And thank you, Manveer, for such a lucid presentation, so neat and clean. Everything was so clear. So coming now to the more unclear part of it, that is melatonin. Melatonin is a hormone also, and it is secreted by the pineal gland. And the relationship of this hormone is not very clear, although yes, it is definitely supposed to affect sleep. It is a sleep hormone, and it has a circadian rhythm, as we all know, that it is basically at night that it becomes, comes out or it is secreted out, especially in the late hours. That means about 2 o'clock onwards. So that is why we tend to give it a little earlier, between 8 and 10, because then its action starts at that time. So it is supposed to be acting when patient, but how effective it is at menopause, or how effective it is get rid of the menopausal insomnia is not very clear. Although, like you did mention earlier, it does also have an effect on progesterone. It is supposed to increase the progesterone level, and also it decreases the LH level. So talking of all the interactions that melatonin has, it does cause that, but it still lacks, you know, the studies are still lacking in showing a definite relationship of melatonin with the sleep in cases of menopausal sleep.
Thank you, Dr. Sonia. I think later on we'll talk more about it, whatever is available in the market and how yes. we are. Okay. Do you have to add anything?
No, I just wanted to say it is considered a very safe thing to yeah. prescribe.
Considered a safe
side effects, etc.
So to the early arousals also, that is if the deficiency is there.
Correct.
Dr. Rajendra Nagarkote, can there be other causes of sleep disturbances beyond these vasomotor symptoms and the
neurological
problems and all that?
One of the main causes could be vasomotor symptoms, because in the vasomotor symptoms, one part of it is the unexpected awakenings that happen at night. The same physiological process which causes the vasomotor symptoms leads to these awakenings, and they suddenly get up in a disturbed state. So vasomotor symptoms, even night sweats, sometimes they have night sweats. So that also can again disturb the sleep. And so therefore vasomotor symptoms as such is an important aspect. That apart, they can have mood disturbances. So very often their mood disturbances, like sometimes depression, sometimes anxiety, these things also add up. And to this is added their social problems. Sometimes they may be having at this age, they may be having social problems, either problems with their children, problem with their daughter-in-law, or sometimes problem with their husbands. So these things again add on to it, and they enhance these mood changes, I mean the mood behaviors. The other aspect of it is what Manvi madam already has highlighted, and that is obesity. Menopause very often leads to obesity. We always say fat 40 and women, so that obesity is a factor, and that leads to sleep apnea, and again that needs to be corrected. And then finally the factor about the atrophy, the vaginal atrophy, which happens at this stage. And with this vaginal atrophy, you have all the correlated symptoms like pruritus, there is vaginal burning, and again related to that, the urogenital problems like nocturia or frequency, for which again they may have to keep getting up at night, and that again disturbs their sleep. So I think it's a complete I would say array of symptoms or causes which can lead to disturbances in this age group.
Thank you, Dr. Nagarkatti. So you have beautifully highlighted it's beyond vasomotor symptoms also. We can have mood disorders also. They can affect the sleep problems, or the sleep problems can also cause the mood disorders. And the same way depression can lead to sleep problems, and sleep problems can also lead on to the...
And if I may say, it's a vicious cycle.
It's a vicious cycle.
Disturbed, your work is disturbed. So there is things like, you know, sleeping at work, sometimes sleeping even during driving.
Yeah.
Jabki aa jati hai. So these things happen, and yes, and then your work is disturbed, and again it sort of adds on to the sleep disturbances.
Yeah. Maninder, can I make a point?
Yeah.
Okay. Sure. I mean, I would like to ask this question either to Dr. Manvir or Dr. Sonia, because see, many a times women come to us with the only complaint of insomnia. They do not have hot flashes, they do not have any urinary symptoms or whatsoever, but they just say that, you know, there is insomnia. Dr. Sonia, have you come across such women, and Dr. Manvir, how do you tackle them? Because you know it's a difficult situation at times.
Later on, as we go along the cases, we'll
okay, great.
Okay, so vasomotor symptoms, they are calling sleep disturbance, or the mood changes, or mood changes lead on to sleep disruption, or vasomotor symptoms are increased. So this is all a vicious cycle which we have to many women go through. And of course, there is age-related changes in sleep pattern also. So that is also one of the important factors. And there we have to look into whether they are taking into some drugs, or their social factors are like that. So that is why they are getting the age-related changes. And then we have to go substance abuse and other sleep disorders which might be associated with these menopausal problems. So now we have analyzed that the patient has some sleep disorder, she has some vasomotor symptoms. So now if we go into the sleep disorder, what is the type of history we should be taking? Detailed history. That is the, like Dr. Manvir mentioned about Pittsburgh sleep quality index. She did not go into same slides. You can just repeat them again, that what is actually the Pittsburgh sleep quality index. Anybody can take it, Manvir, even you can take it.
So I think I want to relate it to Dr. Parag's question. When we see a patient with chronic insomnia, and you're right, they will come in and say is, I haven't slept for dash number of years. My sleep has never been good. We can either follow these structured questionnaires, or I tell people, make your own questionnaire. But what is that information that we need from them? We obviously need to know what is the duration of complaints. We also need to know frequency of complaints. Like, is it on a nightly basis, or is it like every once in a few years I get a bad sleep? Then how long, then you go into the depth of the insomnia. How long does it take you to fall asleep? How many times at night do you wake up? What time do you sleep? What time do you wake up? Do you fluctuate your time from weekend to weekdays? It doesn't happen so much at this generation. It happens much more in the youngsters. But I have seen in my practice, if I don't get into the depth of it, people don't talk about it. I had a lady who was sleeping at 10, 10:30, getting up at 2 and working, seeing on her iPad till 4 a.m. And then she was sleeping at 5. Then she was sleeping in the day. So they can do all sorts of things to themselves. And then you make simple list of anything else. Any choking at night, snoring at night, nocturia, etc. I just want to highlight one point which I didn't get time adequately. Sleep apnea in a woman and a man presentation is very different. So the threshold for detecting sleep apnea in a woman has to be really to a very low level. Why? The presentation of a woman with sleep apnea is insomnia. Why? Because of their arousal threshold. You know, we don't need to get into the depth of what happens, but the men are loud snorers and sleepy. That's their symptom. Women are mild, moderate snorers, but a very bad night. So when they say a very bad night, I have enough in my own practice, and even literature says that, that they will come and say, I can't sleep, I can't sleep. So if you see in practical way, one can say a profile who is a little obese, feeling dull, tired in the day, very bad night, gets up to go to the bathroom very often, think of sleep apnea. So that's a very important thing. They're all under the blanket of insomnia. They get treatment for depression. They put on more weight. The sleep apnea gets much worse. So that's another vicious cycle. So I think in short, make your own set of questions, make them 10, make them 5. Start with the main first question. Are you happy with your sleep? Second question, how do you feel when you wake up in the morning? Are you energetic or do you want to get back into bed? And then you can go forward onto further questions.
Okay. So I think Manveer has rightly now pointed out what how we should be taking history. Because in this, it's all clinical assessment are so far. And as a gynecologist, we'll be doing our clinical assessment only. That's why I highlighted that the history is very, very important. And she has clarified so many things. So now we have talked about menopause, symptoms, hormone relationship, depression, and everything, and Pittsburgh scale, how we should be proceeding with these patients when they are complaining of any mesomotor symptoms, and try to find out their sleep problems, which they can tell us indirectly that we feel fatigued or something. They might not tell you directly, and then you have to go into details. Dr. Manveer, you have already talked about REM and NERM sleep, but can you just explain quickly how this is important in the menopause ladies and how when they are coming to us and as a gynecologist, how do we say what is the sleep pattern?
So this again, this whole chart is for the quality of sleep.
Quality of sleep.
Okay, so like I said, so remember in simple words, there are three dimensions of sleep. One is the quantity, number of hours. You may see people who are sleeping 5 hours, 4 hours, etc. That is hours. Second is quality. So quality, we cannot get a very good clinical assessment unless we do some studies. But people will tell you that, you know, throughout the night, I feel like I'm partly awake. My brain is half awake. I can feel that I'm thinking. I get up, I think, you know, like that. So those people are spending a bulk of their time in stage one sleep. And they get up at bed after 8 hours also, but they are very tired. So that's the quality of sleep. And they will tell you themselves that my quality of sleep is not okay. I want to improve my quality. So their deep sleep is less.
So because the management is going to differ if you find out what is the reasons behind the sleep insufficiency, that means. So she doesn't feel like she's getting a complete sleep. So you have already talked about homeostatic and circadian processes. And
Madam, here, can I ask one question? Is this something similar to what they say with alcohol? The people who have nightcaps with alcohol to just before going to bed, it actually doesn't give them good sleep because alcohol basically puts you in that first sleep. It doesn't put you in the deep sleep.
Yeah, so what alcohol does, it's a very good sleep inducer.
Right.
So I have seen a lot of patients who are telling each other that if you don't sleep, drink alcohol. because it works to induce the sleep. But when the level drops, you will get what is called as an arousal or an awakening. And then it's broken. That's one. Second, if you have sleep apnea, it will worsen the...
Right.
Then you will again wake up. So I have one of the rare things that I saw, I heard yesterday in one of my practices, somebody now has started using marijuana.
Lord.
Oh.
And not a young person, an older person. And somebody told her it induces sleep. And she said that, you know, it really does. It works wonders for me. So this is one of the rare. So these are called, we call them the sleep aids, which people have discovered because they won't sleep very badly, whatever they may get. I also want to say that, you know, in your practice, one, I would say two things, that one, develop this habit of taking a history in a little bit more detail. They don't tell you everything. They come, they will keep on pestering. The third thing is that 3P model. Try and fit people into that 3P model. That works very well. So I'll give you an example that I saw a lady recently in this COVID situation. She is a single person. She lost her husband a few years ago. And if you look back, they will have all that incident has happened. It's gone. She was always a worrier. She lives with by herself. She was all right. But she tended to be a little worried at times. But that was her. So that is a first P. That is a predisposing characteristic. COVID came. She got really worried about getting the stuff from the stores and markets to her house. How to clean them. So that became a precipitating event. She just couldn't handle it. She said, and she knows it. She kept telling me that I got scared so badly. When the anxiety just got on, she got palpitations. She started breaking out into sweats. They thought it's a cardiac event. So she reached the emergencies at night. So that was all said. It's okay. You're all right. Go back home. She shifted to her daughter's house or whatever. Everybody got COVID.
Oh.
So she was brought here in a state of total severe anxiety. So her predisposition was there. A precipitating event has occurred. And now the thought has become that I don't think I'm going to live. Everybody's going to die. My whole family is. And her worry about sleep and her worry about the health is the third P. So to improve her, we have to tackle. So we can't tackle the first P. That is her nature, not yet. So we have to, in our mind, prioritize what do I tackle right now. So to her, I had to give her a benzodiazepine to calm her down. Otherwise, her pulse rate is reaching 130, 140. So I think in our, like you have in everything else in clinical practice, we need to pick up the point, what is important to that person, tackle that point and stop the practice of giving sleeping pills to all. That is my basic concern, that we are seeing people who are on muthiya bhar bhar ke goliya kha rahe types.
So that's why menopause management is always a multidisciplinary team effort. So I have taken this initiative to bring another expert in our menopause management, and perhaps Manmeet, you should join our societies now, because it's very much needed and we need more of sleep therapies. Anyway, going back to our menopause, now you know, Parag, that vasomotor symptoms are responsible for some of the mood problems, some of the sleep problems also. So how you are going to treat for the hot flushes, at least are the vasomotor symptoms?
Okay. Manindar, I'll refer to both the patients that you have put across. The first is an obese woman, and second, I believe, is
Narendra, Rajendra will take vaginal symptoms. You take
But she also has vasomotor symptoms anyway.
Yeah.
All right. So, first and foremost will be a lifestyle modification where we expect them to reduce caffeine. So, she has to reduce a cup of coffee or tea or whatever. Stop smoking. Alcohol, diet has to be improved, and you may take help of a dietitian to improve on that. We have to ensure that she does exercise for about 45 minutes under typical weight-bearing aerobic exercise. You are the expert in it, so you know these things better. And this advice will be common for each and every woman. Now, regarding two cases, one who is a 52-year-old with vasomotor symptoms and the other who is obese. Now, the first lady who's who doesn't have any the contraindications for giving hormone therapy, I would certainly opt for menopausal hormone therapy. Of course, a pre-assessment is a must, where we would certainly like to check her weight, her blood pressure. We would examine her in detail, do certain investigations, which would include lipid profile, thyroid, sugar, etc. We would certainly do a pap smear and plus minus HPV testing. A baseline ultrasound and a baseline mammography is very important. And for this woman, I would, my first choice would be to prescribe her menopausal hormone therapy. If the uterus is intact, we would prescribe her estrogen plus progesterone. If she's hysterectomized, only estrogen would do. And if the for the first lady who is obese, whose BMI was 33, menopausal hormone therapy would not be the first choice. I would certainly like to depend more on other therapies, which would include phytoestrogens. These are weak estrogens, which may work in some women, though there's not enough evidence. Or there are some compounds like ERR-731, which has come up recently, and it also works to a certain extent in women where the vasomotor symptoms are taken care of, and of course, their quality of sleep also improves. Perhaps the best combination would be estrogen plus bazedoxifene. Unfortunately, it is not available. There's enough literature about the safety as well as efficacy of this combination. So if at all we get this combination, it would certainly do wonders to our women.
That's, I think, a real true menopause specialist is talking about. So you have to go first assess her, then you start with the menopause hormone therapy. Manvi, sometimes we cannot give menopause hormone therapy, like in breast cancer survivors, and they have lots of these problems. So then can we give them SSRIs and SNRIs when they are having sleep problems also?
See, again, I would say that be cautious in giving the SSRI or the SNRI. As of now, they are not accepted as or recommended by the American Academy of Sleep Medicine as first-line treatments. So if you are sure by the assessment that there is definitely an underlying comorbid depression existing, then maybe we are justified to give them. Otherwise, we have to draw their full cycle of their day and their night, figure out what are they doing wrong, and that is a CBTI. We integrate our approach into their behavioral techniques, into their negative thinking, sleep hygiene. Now, looking at this, during this time, actually it's been in my mind for quite some time, I have started myself a 4-week, 6-week program. At each week, then I give them a little homework, I give them a sleep diary, I give them a write-up on what they are supposed to do, and they are supposed to report back to me in 7 to 10 days. That's the only way. So it's a continuity of care with instructions, with guidance, that they can stay away from the medications, because sleep is an issue. So they need somebody, like it's called, hand-holding them through the time. But yes, like that lady who I talked about, I would give her an SSRI and maybe an anti-anxiety to help her. But I think the other thing which the American Academy or all the sleep medicine people are saying is that please specify the time. So if you write a prescription, write that you are writing it for 2 weeks and clearly underline that I have explained side effects and I have explained do not continue and how to, what are the harmful effects. Because patients are on this prescription for years once you write it. So the duration is our job to write it and our responsibility to tell them.
I think, Manvi, that you have given a very good guiding principles. And which are the days when you are taking these classes? On Facebook?
No. So I'm not taking it. I'm like,
as public awareness programs.
Yeah, no, what I'm doing is individually with the patient. So like, okay, if the patient. I have booked her for the next 4 weeks. Okay. I explained to her, okay, now this is not going to be okay in one session. I need 4 to 5 weeks, but I will see you every week and you book your 4 appointments.
Okay. Dr. Rajendra Nagarkoti now.
Sonia Malik was one. Yeah. Sonia Malik was saying something.
there is a group of patients, you know, they're so anxious and say they are so depressed, maybe, I don't know, but anxious, yes.
Anxious.
They want a quick fix. They are not ready to listen to this advice that you're saying and this diary and all this therapy that
we are exposing.
So what do you do for them as a quick fix?
So I see this quick fix, I have started telling people it will not work.
Okay.
Yeah, because what happens is, if it is like...
Can you not give these for a short while, maybe, you know, just to tide over that period till she understands?
So
because
she,
what happens is she's so sleepless that she does need something, you know, to relax her before we get her into this mode.
Sure. So then you can give... So if you're sure it is only insomnia, it is nothing else, there's no RLS, there is no sleep apnea, you can give zolpidem for a short period.
Yes.
But give that zolpidem for a short period, make sure it is 10 days, 2 weeks, 3 weeks and off. But we have to...
So it should not be continued for a long time.
That's understandable.
But there, this is a fresh patient, it's different.
Yes.
I'm talking about these people who are all on medications.
Yeah, of course. Yes.
And they are like just not able to get off. Their doses have gone very high.
Yeah.
They walk into the daytime still looking sleepy, but saying, I've not slept.
Yeah, but basically, see, the patients that I have referred to you are generally those who have been sleeping and during the day, eating their breakfast also, they go off to sleep.
So those are sleep apnea.
They are not, they are sleep apnea. They are not insomnia.
Yeah.
That kind of a difference, you, but we are talking of menopause, which is an event which could have triggered it as well, like the precipitating factor.
It could be a precipitating.
That little help at that time, no?
Sure. So that medication for short term is recommended.
Yes.
We give the medicine, upper limit being 10 to 12 weeks and then stop.
Okay.
But when we are reaching that 8-10 weeks, we should start thinking that what do I do?
Yeah, of course.
When patients have these symptoms of vasomotor symptoms, so when we need it, we can give them. And if the patient's sleep improves, it's fine. If it doesn't improve, then we'll send it to you.
Sure. No. You should put something to tide them over the crisis. We need to tide them over. I'm talking about those chronic...
Among the SSRIs and the SNRIs, which do you think is the best, especially in terms of... I think venlafaxine, is it the most commonly used?
Venlafaxine has now become commonly used because it has little better tolerance. But venlafaxine is a morning dose.
Okay.
It's one of those alerting SSRIs.
Okay.
So if you want a sedating SSRI, then mirtazapine is better.
Which one, ma'am?
Mirtazapine.
Mirtazapine.
Okay. Trazodone is better. So those are the ones which are being recommended, that they have an antidepressant action and a sedating action.
So they have the vasomotor symptoms as well.
So vasomotor symptoms, I don't know. I'm just giving this for depression, insomnia.
Okay.
Our studies, they have shown effect in the vasomotor symptoms also.
Yeah.
For the medicine, we are advising, especially in breast cancer survivors, but we are not advising fluoxetine because of the, when they are on tamoxifen. So now, Dr. Rajinder, we come to you about that urea problem. So you have to hit the nail on the head now.
Yes. Yes, genitourinary problem, as I said, it comes under the new terminology of GSM. There are different aspects of it. That is the urological aspects. There is the vaginal or the vaginal vulval aspect. And then, of course, there is also the sexual aspect. So in the urinary problems, one of the common things which we already discussed, nocturia, is that's probably because of an overactive bladder. And here we can give them the antimuscarinic agents are the gold standard. Generally, we can use either solifenacin or darifenacin. Solifenacin is given in a dose of 5 milligrams once a day. You can give it, go up to 10 milligrams, and darifenacin is 7.5 milligrams once a day, can go up to twice a day. Or up to maximum of 15 milligrams. Of course, we have to remember that they should be tested for increased intraocular pressure, because in glaucomas, they are contraindicated. Another thing that is important is, along with this, you need to also give them a behavioral therapy. And that is where the sleep hygiene and those things come. You also have to talk about, how to avoid excessive fluid intake at night and change their sleeping habits, have a peaceful bedroom, generally they say that you should not have your desk inside your bedroom, you know, the desk where you have your papers, where you have your bills attached to the ward, I mean, to the board. So you keep seeing those bills and those are going to cause anxiety. So things like that. So that all comes under the sleep hygiene. So that is one aspect of it. There is a new drug for the OAB, that is mirabegron, which is given in a dose of 50 milligram once a day and has been found to be effective in those cases where especially darphenazine or sulfenazine doesn't work. For the vaginal atrophy, which causes the vaginal irritation, and again that irritation leads to sleep disturbances, there one can generally use local vaginal preparations, which generally use estriol, which is a low potent estrogen and has very good efficacy locally. We start by giving it daily initially, and then after say 10 days or after 2 weeks, then we can give a maintenance of twice a week dosage. Along with this, or in those patients who are not willing to go for hormonal therapy, in term, even though it is local, if they're not willing, then Parag mentioned, there are these alternative therapies. There are nowadays phytoestrogen cream. There is a this called as Isrin gel, which contains a phytoestrogen, and that can be used twice a week, and they have also given reasonably good efficacy. There are also estrogen pessaries, which are available, estrogen rings, which can be used, and ospemifene is another drug which can be tried for these patients. Of course, I think it's not yet available in India, but it's one of the new drugs. It's a third generation SERM, which can be given. Even the second generation, that is the TSEC complex, can be used. That is the tissue selective estrogen complex, which is a combination of an SERM like bezetoxifene along with conjugated estrogen. These combinations have also been found to be useful in the vulvovaginal atrophy patients, and they have a beneficial effect on bone as well. So they have a beneficial effect on bone, a beneficial effect on the, without having any effect on the uterus or the endometrium. So therefore, these are the various drugs which can be tried. And along with that, of course, the lifestyle modulations. I have a way of remembering ABCD, that is avoid excessive alcohol, avoid excessive coffee. B is for vitamins, B complex vitamin C is for vitamin C, D is for vitamin D, E is for exercise, H is for the hormonal therapy wherever required, the MHT, then of course there is the other extra hormonal therapies which can be given, that is the non-hormonal therapies. So these different modes of managements are the what we call it lifestyle modulations.
Dr. Rajinder, nicely covering that we can tackle at the urinary bladder level, vaginal or the sexuality level issue, so that when she doesn't have these problems and she doesn't have to get up in the night only, so she will be benefited from the sleep disorders also. Now, Dr. Sonia Malik, we are talking about now integrative medicine. It's no more complementary medicine or alternative medicine or the standard medicine. Which we are using now, it's a multi-billion dollar industry of integrative medicine. So what is the role of, now we come to melatonin, which you were talking about, exercise, yoga. Exercise, because everybody has talked about it. So I must say, mention one thing, that you should be doing exercise in the morning and not in the night. Because if you are going to do in the night, you are going to be waking up and not sleeping. So do in the morning. So please, Sonia Malik.
So before I go on to this, let me just tell you one little thing that Maninder told me many years ago. She asked me, when do you exercise? And I, as you can see, I don't. So then she said, don't you ever brush your teeth? I said, yes. So she says, why can't you exercise if you brush your teeth every day? So this is for the audience also, that if you brush your teeth every day, you have to exercise also every day. I'm listening to Maninder now. And therefore, coming back to the menopausal insomnia and menopausal sleep disorders, yes, like you said, and I'm so glad that Manveer has been talking about this, the integrative therapy and all this kind of thing, which we are always talking about in menopausal medicine. More than anything else, it is the counseling of the patient which is most important. And even over here, you know that besides giving the medicines and besides talking to her about all her problems, we all have to talk and talk and actually tell her what is right and wrong. And that is what it is, just that we have to structure it properly. And like she said, that this behavioral therapy, the cognitive behavioral therapy, has various aspects to it. There is something called sleep restriction also, wherein you advise the patient to get into bed only when she can sleep well, to avoid those hours when, and probably this is for those people who can't sleep right in the beginning. For people who can wake up later on, it may not be that effective. But for those who have a problem in getting into bed and sleeping, they should try to get into bed only when they are very, very sleepy. So that is sleep restriction. Then, of course, you have to control the stimulus. There is something called stimulus control, which means you are trying to avoid those things which are actually leading to a sleep deprivation. And of course, like we said, cognitive therapy is extremely important, and all those sessions that Manveer has told us about are important. And of course, sleep hygiene, as Dr. Rajendra has mentioned, yes, very, very important. Those things have to be avoided. And of course, if she gets a hot flash with something, that needs to be taken care of. Cooling substances, having a cold bath at night, or things like that, which might help her to get a better sleep. And then relaxation training. For that, yoga, as you said. And then there is something called yog nidra, which is very much practiced by all the yoga teachers. This is just a slow, monotonous way of, reciting either a song, singing a song, or some kind of a shloka, so that the patient goes into that kind of a sleep. So something which soothes her nerves and therefore causes it. And this slide that you've put up about diet, I do not know how much this is true, whether these are food fads from Google dear or it is actually true. But yes, there are certain foods which might cause indigestion or acidity to this patient. And we also know that if she is suffering from hyperacidity, that also can lead to problems in sleep, and she may get up with GERD, as we call it, and suddenly she has a reflux, and that itself can be a cause for sleep apnea as well. Or she may have not a very restful sleep. So these are factors which we need to take care of. And coming back to our dear melatonin, yes, that is a drug which can be prescribed. Like I said, if she needs a quick fix, maybe, because it's very safe and it doesn't cause side effects. It doesn't have side effects. And the patient can be given. But it is said that if it is given in doses more than 5 milligram, it is not of any use. So up to a dose of 5 milligram, generally given early at night, between 8 and 10 o'clock at night, and that can help the patient to have a good sleep. So these things definitely need to be tried in order to help this woman who is really deprived of her sleep. That is what I can say.
I think, as usual, Sonia, you have come out with the very beautiful things, especially yog nidra and all that. And Dr. Sonia Malik postponed one of our webinars, got it post, because she was convinced that, yes, this topic needs to be discussed and the discussions have to start. Now, this patient has taken the menopause hormone therapy, local therapy, whatever. Dr. Rajinder and Parag Biniwale told her, and she was very happy that, of course, I don't have any hot flushes, I don't have any nocturia problems. But then she was having daytime fatigue. She was feeling drowsy, goes to sleep in the office. She has difficulty in driving also. She has gained weight now. And as Dr. Manveer was told us how they go into a vicious cycle of gaining weight. And this time her husband has come with her. So now, Dr. Parag and Nagarkoti, you be careful, because he informs now that she's snoring at night, and sometimes she chokes or stops breathing also, and he's worried now. So what you would be doing now? Now is the time to call Dr. Manveer Bhatia, or just let's quickly discuss first, because this patient has now come with overweight, with all these problems. Would you do some other tests also to find out if there are health hazards of sleep disorders in her case? Because so far we have not done any investigation except for the routine for the menopausal required. should we be doing her diabetes, hypertension profiles, kidney profiles? Anybody? Manveer, can you take up?
Yeah, so I thought in the beginning also her BMI was about 33. And like I said, that they come with the problem on the surface being poor sleep and vasomotor symptoms. But one should think and keep in mind about the sleep apnea. And that's why we will do, like I agree, it's a very nice way of doing a multidisciplinary approach. But now sleep apnea seems to be at the foremost. We should, and we know, like I was presenting in that slide, that they are at risk for cardiovascular. Sleep apnea themselves puts them at risk. Menopause puts them at risk. A risk of hypertension, which is about 2 to 3 times more. A risk of diabetes, which is again about 2 to 3 times more, and things like that. So what would we do? We would actually now advise a test, which is called as a sleep study. So there are, what is a sleep study? It measures through the night, focus being on breathing, snoring, oxygen through the night. Depending upon what else we record, we can also record their sleep. And these are the two types of tests which are done. One is a simple test, which is only what is called as a home sleep test or a simple test, breathing, oxygen, snoring, and ones which you put multiple wires, that's done in the laboratories or centers. But it gives you enough information. Is there sleep apnea? Yes or no? And severity of sleep apnea. So that needs to be documented.
Yeah, so now we have gone for further investigations now. And snoring is a big problem. Sometimes it can lead to divorces also. Do you agree, Dr. Rajendra Nagarkoti?
So in our
snoring
area,
is a big problem. So
in our, I think divorces don't happen. Separate bedrooms are very often. I have seen a lot of people who all moved into separate bedrooms.
Yeah, that is snoring. That is the social distancing ka bahana liya hai.
Yes, wo bahut ne pehle bhi tha. So divorce kam hota hai, but alag alag ho jaate hain.
So they go into their separate bedrooms.
I think
so
it's
one very important issue which we are never discussing is why we are having these nightmares.
I think nightmares, Dr. Manindra, is like a separate topic by itself. It's almost nearing 6. Maybe we should.
Okay.
Nightmares is a
but
very.
Can you just quickly say what are the reasons for nightmares? Quickly.
So first of all, nightmares are bad dreams.
Yeah.
Scary
bad
dreams.
So we have already covered this weight gain causes sleep apnea. Yeah,
so
and we have discussed.
Madam, this Manveer madam, you said about sleep apnea and snoring. Normally, it's detected. It's informed to you by your partner, isn't it? That
partner, yeah, partner only. That's why I told you that husband has come now and he has informed about those symptoms.
In their lighter stages, they can hear themselves snore.
They can hear themselves.
But yes. Ladies don't snore much. You said that.
No, their intensity is not as loud as the men because they do snore. They will snore.
They do snore, and the overweight obese women do snore. So sometimes progesterone, when we are giving in a menopause hormone therapy, that also relaxes them. So polysomnography, I think Manveer, we can leave that.
Yeah, we should leave.
One condition which we have to talk about is the GERD. Gastrointestinal reflex in disorder.
Webinar.
Anybody can take it because this is can be related to insomnia. Choking will be there.
Yeah.
And so then you have to avoid the heavy meals at the bedtime, and the proton pump inhibitors and H2 are the one which are given them. But it has to be identified.
It has to be, yes, and that's why we talked
definitely
about
definitely identified and talked.
Type of food, what type of food, timing of food, interval between last meal and the bedtime.
Yeah.
So these are the drugs which are given them. So they also help it. But the main thing is that it has to be diagnosed because
it causes
choking sensation is there.
But if you diagnose it and they take the CPAP, they are helped.
This is one side where the CPAP helps these women. Where the, of course, the GERD was improved, but not the insomnia at the night. So for that, they had to take the CPAP also. So he's not in ICU. That is the CPAP. Manveer? So stepwise medical management, we have talked about these things, periodic limb movements, polysomnography, that is there. What is actigraphy?
So actigraphy is simply, it's like an activity monitor, which initially they came up as simple wristwatches, but they give a more detailed. But now you have numerous sleep monitors, which are all around the place, from Fitbit to Apple watches, which are all trying to do. So they're all trying to do it by activity monitors.
Okay, so those are the sleep activity watches only. So can you have to add anything on the drugs and drug interactions?
No, I think I should just say that you be careful when, especially women at this stage come to us, like late 50s, 60s or whatever, they are on a host of drugs. So when we talk about insomnia, we should take a drug history. Some people may be taking a diuretic by mistake at night. They've got confused. Some people may be taking a beta blocker at night, will give nightmares, asthma medications very late. So these kind of things. So some, because they have a lot of health issues. So look at the medical history.
I think sleep hygiene, all of us have talked about already. I think all the panelists, they have discussed the sleep hygiene, but that is very, very important. That give the bedroom place only, not the other activities like Rajendra said, TV, mobile off, no alcohol, which have been discussed. Perhaps a bath, taking bath before bed is going to help. Right food, we have discussed, right spacing. Get up, if you don't feel like sleeping, then don't try to make yourself sleep. Get up, do something, and by that time, perhaps you will be sleepy again. But don't count the sheep or stars. Is that okay, Manveer?
Yes. You have to get out of bed.
Yeah. So we have to sleep hygiene. So main thing is that we have to identify the influence of the hormones, circadian rhythm, lifestyle changes, depression, insomnia, restless leg syndrome, sleep apnea. We have to diagnose them by the history only, and subjective system symptoms of the patient, they should be looked into. Then additional aid, Dr. Manveer Bhatia can help us by polysomnography, wrist actigraphy, or doing the sleep studies. And treatment is, of course, firstly, cognitive behavioral therapy, continuous positive pressure when needed. But menopause hormone therapy is, of course, helping wherever the psychomotor, wherever the vasomotor symptoms are there. So basically, carry home message is that the sleep difficulties in midlife women are common in the menopause transition. They are multifactorial, can be with the hot flushes, anxiety, depressive, or can be the primary disorders or comorbid conditions also. So they have to be diagnosed and refer the women for evaluation if sleep disorder is being suspected, because that's not only going to help, affect her quality of life, but morbidity and mortality issues also, because sleep apneas and the choking can lead on to the even sleep deaths also sometimes rarely. So they have to be referred in time. And very, very important thing, please all of you listen, legend says, when you cannot sleep at night, it is because you are awake in someone else's dream. Please let me sleep. So everyone who is sharing, dreaming about me, stop dreaming about me and let me have a healthy, happy sleep for everybody. Thank you to my panelists for being so great, especially to Dr. Manveer Bhatia. And my main purpose was to invite Dr. Manveer Bhatia and to make everybody realize that all the sleep problems are important. And my really panelists, all the three of them, and the fourth one, the specialist, Manveer Bhatia, has done a good work. And thank you to some people also. And thank you very much to all the attendees who have been there. And I think it has benefited everybody. Three cheers for everybody.
Can we take some questions?
Yes.
Is there time? Okay.
Yes, please take some questions. Actually.
So many of the questions are overlapping. They are asking, how can I sleep better during menopause, or best treatment for sleep disorder? I think we've discussed during menopause. What do you say, Dr. Manveer?
Yeah, I think that we've covered already. That, you know, it's a very, how can I sleep better, then, is a very broad topic. We need to find
out. And yes.
Right. Sure.
Does lack of sleep lead to weight gain?
Yes. So lack of sleep is an interesting question. Yeah, so there is a very good correlation between short sleep due to any reason and obesity. Why? Okay. There are these two hormones, ghrelin and leptin, which they tell you what to eat, I tell them, and when to stop eating. So both go haywire in simple terms. So you tend to eat a lot more. You also make what is called as poor choices of food. You want carbohydrate rich food. So these children who are staying awake at night, in my teenager lectures that I'm going to talk about, they have a big problem about this night eating. So, and
even I have.
They eat, you don't look
at it. You're a teenager.
They eat the wrong kind of stuff.
But you don't look it. You don't look obese.
Yeah, so it's
the
choices.
Precious eater at
all of the satiety center and the appetite are all go haywire. So it's a very strong correlation between the two.
Any role of shavasana or meditation in getting to sleep?
Sonia Malik put it together. When I showed that CBTI, which I will keep repeating, usme there is a component called as relaxation.
Yes.
So whatever relaxes you, I tell people, it can be shavasana, it can be yog nidra, it can be deep breathing, it can be visual imagery. Imagine you are sitting in Switzerland or the Alps or whatever. Do something to break the continuity of the thought. And that is how you will decrease, in scientific ways we know how it works. It decreases your sympathetic system, improves your parasympathetic system, and that's what you want to get sleep. So
somebody has asked, does giving hormones help in sleep? I think we've covered it. Primary sleep disorders due to sleep apnea or chronic depression or combination. I think they need to come to you for that.
So primary sleep disorders are what we call as sleep apnea, RLS, etc. Then we have a comorbid sleep disorder, which is like with depression. And I do want to emphasize that any individual can have both, can have all three. So the problem arises sometimes we treat one and we don't treat the other. So there could be insomnia and sleep apnea.
Okay.
So there could be depression plus sleep apnea. So if I treat one, I don't treat the other. Patient will not get better. So they can have sleep apnea, they can have RLS, they can have depression. And just to add before we start prescribing a lot of these SSRIs worsen RLS. So if your lady comes back and tells you, jab se maine ye dawai khai, my legs are just giving way and my sleep has become really bad. She had hidden RLS, which has now surfaced, or we didn't talk about it earlier, and she has worsened. Then they will just take off. The legs will just take off with mirtazapine. So be careful when. That's why. So it's a lot of detail history before we advise them anything.
Sleep therapy is a specialty in itself.
Yes, yes. Exactly.
Yeah.
Somebody has asked for a shortcut, best medicine for sleep.
Yeah, I think. I agree that in practice, we need to have something in our resource as this pill, as we call it. So we, in fact, in the sleep medicine say that this is the most inexpensive, cheap kind of a substitute is a CBTI. It has no side effects given to women of all age, pregnancy, anybody. You don't bother about it's going to harm. Except we are not supposed to give it for people who are severe psychiatric or severe bipolars, etc. So Zolpidem, etc., which are shorter Z drugs for shorter durations, but be careful what is short and how you stop it, you know.
You cannot give them for more than 5 weeks.
So upper limit is about 10 to 12 weeks.
10 to 12 weeks you can give.
Which one, ma'am? Zolpidem?
There are some esopiclone has been tried for even 4, 5, 6 months. But you know, I am a little wary of telling anybody, a patient straight away, that you take it for 3 months. So recommendation is you give it for 4 weeks and call them back.
When do we come to see you?
Melatonin duration for how long? So,
melatonin is a wonderful thing like we discussed. But to say that melatonin for chronic insomnia may not work. But yes, if somebody has what we call it as a delayed sleep onset, or you're wanting to help them change their time. So we call this resetting their circadian rhythm. that they were sleeping at 1 or 2. Now they want to sleep at 11, 12. Wo apne aap, that 2 hours will not happen. So we can give them melatonin. Melatonin, another thing to remember, it takes a few hours. So melatonin is not like a sleeping pill. It's nothing like Zolpidem. Zolpidem you have to take and go to bed. Also remember. So melatonin will go slowly up and down. So they have to take it about 4 to 5 hours preceding their bedtime. So very often people take melatonin at 11 o'clock and say it did nothing.
Won't help.
So it has to be taken 8:39. You can give it for long. You can give it for, it's not really harmful, but it's, you have to think about why you're giving it and then start taking it off. I have some young girl who's sitting in Lucknow. She was, came down during lockdown, extremely bad timings and, you know, with her work to home. So she's now pretty well. She's doing on melatonin and other sleep hygiene. So she's done well.
And Parkinsonism and sleep medication, how does the combination work?
This is a very specific question. So
yes,
we touch about another area which Dr. Maninder touched a little bit lightly, something called as nightmares, you know. So yeah. I just want to add, so nightmare is a bad dream. Then there is a something called acting out your dream. I mean, I can't talk about that in too much detail here. But if you get a patient, it especially happens in the elderly. It is more common in men, but now we are seeing women. It's called acting out your dream. That means that I found as a robber coming into my house or to my room, and you hold the bed partner and squeeze their hand or throat or finger. I have people who thought there's a lion and almost choked their wife or has broken the finger. So that's called acting out your dream. That is now an indication for a neurodegenerative disorder to come. So that's just that you need to remember it. It's that in case you've got a history, what does it mean? Coming to your Parkinsonism, Parkinsonism, Parkinson's and sleep disorders are very closely related. So PD by itself can affect sleep. It has a lot of, and then the disease can affect sleep, the medications, they're very closely related. Let's put it like that. We need to understand a lot more than we can help patients with that.
And anti-snoring appliances given by dentists, do they help in controlling snoring?
So we talked about snoring, but with the snoring, if it is loud, if it is persistent, we should get a sleep study to document sleep apnea. Sleep apnea, we divide into mild, moderate, severe, based on some value that we get. So for mild sleep apnea, the dental treatments will work. The dental devices. So, but okay. For moderate, maybe they may work, but moderate is more of CPAP. Okay. So we have to be very clear what we are treating.
What we are treating.
Because we may decrease the intensity of the sound. That is what snoring. Mm. But you may not improve sleep apnea. Then as we discussed, yes, you are leaving the individual for risk, for cardiovascular consequences, metabolic consequences, and diabetes, hypertension, etc. So if we are just treating the sound will go down, the intensity.
Are we doing the surgeries also in sleep apnea?
Yeah, so there is a role of surgery in sleep apnea. But again, it's how to select the patient for surgery. So, and what surgery? So if there's a nasal surgery, we have to be very clear and sure that there is a nasal obstruction. And what are you trying to remove? That's one. Second, if there is multi-level obstruction, which is most often the case with sleep apnea, especially in obese people, the obstruction is posterior pharyngeal wall, retroglossal, behind the tongue. Those surgeries are not successful and they will cause a problem. So simple nasal surgery, somebody who's got severe deviated septum, can't breathe only through one nostril and thin built, then we should say, okay, let's treat the nose.
So, and what about, next question is, what about afternoon naps if somebody wants to can't?
Yeah, that's a good question. I didn't have time to address it. So, nap is what is, that's why they're called as power naps.
Yeah.
And to go back on our discussion about stages of sleep, a nap is good if it is depending upon what time. So afternoon means early afternoon, not 4, 5 p.m. We have a circadian dip, which is physiological around that time, early afternoon. So people will feel that you've had lunch, you get that little feel of snooze. So that time, if, and so that's one time, that's about 2 to 33. Most important is duration of nap. So 10 to 15 minutes is fine. It will, in fact, some people feel that they've got a new day, which is true. So why? Because you will be in stage one and stage two, and you will get up. If you stay longer, you will enter into deep sleep. And when you get up from deep sleep, you're very groggy, you're more tired, and it is called a state that you can't concentrate, you can't focus, you're more irritable, and it will affect your night sleep. So awesome. Short naps, timing of nap, they definitely work if you can get it.
And one more question somebody has asked, antique for nocturia. Sir, aapko. Hello?
Kya question?
And anticholinergic drugs for nocturia, getting up in the night to go to the loo.
Dr. Rajendra.
Oh, yeah, that's what I said, sir has to answer.
Yeah, I already mentioned it. The most commonly used today are solifenacin and darifenacin.
Mm-hmm.
See, we used to use tolterodine, which was available as Terol LA. But I think today the most commonly what we are using is oxybutynin, of course, is given up. But we are using solifenacin and darifenacin, which are the anticholinergics or antimuscarinics, as we call them. And I also mentioned about the new drug which is available, which is a beta-3 agonist, and that is mirabegron.
Will it worsen the hesitancy in elderly?
Yeah, it can give rise to cognitive disorders. So that is one point that we need to take the history, especially if they're a little elderly and if they are more towards having cognitive problems, then it can worsen them. So, yes.
That's a little tricky.
Yeah.
Double-ish. So this is the list of
questions. So that is where the mirabegron is safe in them, man. Mirabegron is a safer drug, has a better safety profile, and the only thing that you need to check for mirabegron is hypertension and probably renal impairment.
I think, Manmeet, we should end the session now.
Yeah.
Yeah, and
we finished with the questions.
We have more sessions, I think, in other topics related. There are so many things we still have to discuss. It is just a start, and I think let's continue with these things.
But wonderful. Congratulations, madam, for selecting a wonderful topic.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Manveer, to take us through so beautifully.
Thank you so much. I enjoyed my interaction.
Thank you, Vanita.
Secondly, on 21st, I will be having a multidisciplinary care of women in Faridabad itself. So I'll be sending the link to all of you. So the how the other specialties are perceiving menopause and menopausal women. So that is one, I think, another webinar. And after that, how to control your midriff, how to pull in your tummy tuck. That will be 3 series of webinars for the tummy tuck on exercise. Thank you very much, Manveer. I'm really indebted to you. And thank you to all the panelists, Sonia. She's a wonderful friend, and Dr. Narajinder, Dr. Prag Binivale, and my 2 wonderful chairpersons, both Anitas, Anita Shah and Anita Khan, and both are like my right hand only, because whenever I need them, they are there to help me out. Thank you very much.
Dr. Jignesh, who's here till the end.
Yes. And cheering up there. Also.
Jignesh,
are you there? Yes. Hello, Jignesh. Are you there?
So many thumbs up he gave us all throughout.
Thank you very much.
I'm hearing because this is very important topic.
It is.
I've given a
new counseling. It is very important.
Yeah.
Yes.
Very nice of you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Sun, for organizing this for us.
Thank you.
I want to thank Sun, I think, for helping us and organizing. Promptly, immediately said that they would help us.
Thank you. Yeah, Sanjay is there. I think we have been having the most interactive this last fortnight.
Yeah, correct.
Make a flat everything. Thank you very much. I think we
Thank you.
Bye
bye. Thank you, everyone. Parag.
Yeah. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Oh, okay.
Bye.
Okay, Parag.
Bye.
Bye.
Buddy from very beginning in the Foxy.
So Dinesh ji, shall we end the session? Dinesh ji, we are ending the session now. Thanks for all your support, Dinesh ji.